Hello.
Blog Talk Radio.
Hello. Hello, and welcome to the Goddess Suite. This is Holistic Gals. Who else is on the line?
Yes, Mystic Feather here.
Hello, Mystic Feather. How are you doing this evening?
Just beautiful. Holistic Gal, how are you?
I'm feeling great. I had to get me a cup of tea and inhale some of my peppermint oil to wake me up a little bit. Just a little bit. Been feeling a little tired lately. So I had to use my holistic remedies that works all the time. I use peppermint oil at work also when I seem to get a little bored, when I have to sit at my desk and do notes. So that kind of revives me and helps wake me up, perk me up a little bit.
Yes, I might need to pull mine out too.
Yeah, I'm telling you, put some in the palm of your hand, rub your hands together, inhale deep a couple of times, and your eyes are like pop open. You'll be like, "Woof, wow, okay."
Oh, okay. I must try that.
Yes, ma'am. Well, you know, tonight we will be bringing back Mr. Steve Johnson, historian, author of the book, How Did I Get Here from a Kushite to a Thug? But first, as always, we play a song that's related to the topic. So tonight we're going to be talking a little bit about melanin, and we most likely will go into a little bit about the third eye. So we're going to play a song from Roy Ayers called The Third Eye, and we'll be back in a couple of minutes. All right.
Seeking to find
Hello, welcome back to the Goddess Suite. That was Roy Ayers with the Third Eye. Mr. Feather, are you on the line?
Yes, I'm here.
All right. Well, oh,
that
without
was beautiful.
Hmm.
I said that song was beautiful, and I'm just amazed at how conscious people were way back then. You know, I was watching. Our grandmother had the Soul Train collection of DVDs, and I was just looking at the old Soul Train shows, and I just want to say that people were more conscious back then than they are now. I'm just looking at, you know, so many different things and the music and things like that, and even Roy Ayers, I mean, he was before his time, and now we look at the Third Eye as something evil. It's just amazing to me how quickly we forget, you know, that 30 years ago they were talking about the same thing. When I was watching Soul Train, I noticed that when they would do the question and answers with the guest that was on the show and the dancers.
Right.
The dancers always would ask the guest, what's your sign? You know, this was like so like normal. I mean, I watched at least 5 episodes and they always asked, what's your sign? So these things were not spooky back then. It's just amazing how times have changed and we fell back asleep, you know.
Yeah, you just wonder when exactly did that transition happen? Because, like you said, when we would watch the old episodes of Soul Train, and people just seemed much more freer. You know, they had the big afros. Men wore color, didn't just wear, you know, black or gray. But they actually wore, you know, blue, pink, yellow, red. I mean, it was like the color of the rainbow. So you just wonder, when did that shift happen? When did we kind of fall back asleep, I guess, you know?
You know what? I really believe that during the 80s, most likely, you know, we were just born. But I really believe that the war on drugs really brought a lot of our people down. And then it birthed children who were asleep. You know, you had so many wonderful people that were just taken out from the drug war, from, you know, them pumping drugs in our communities, guns, and all these things to kill ourselves with. And it just seemed like from there, because, you know, the 70s was a good era. That was a love era, as well as the 60s. But it just seemed like in the 80s, you know, the war on drugs, crack cocaine, a lot of those things just tore our people down, you know. So, of course, the offspring, you know, without that type of knowledge being fed to the offspring, it just seems like, you know, the children just fell back asleep. But the good thing is that now that we're in the new millennium, people are waking back up. So we're happy about that.
Yeah. I give thanks for that, and I feel like that's part of the Goddess, that's part of our mission, is to help awaken the younger, you know, the younger generation. I mean, older too, but I just feel like it may be a little easier with the younger generation, you know, because
they don't have as much programming to get through.
They have what people call their issues, I guess, but I feel like at least the younger generation, they're kind of free. I mean, I work at a high school, and it's funny because these children already have tattoos, and I'm like 35, and I'm like scared to get a tattoo.
Yeah.
I would like to get one, but it's like they don't fear anything, and it's like
they're so free,
you know?
Right. And see, we're the past couple of generations, you know, well, not the past couple, but over the past, 50 years, you know, the church has a lot of influence on, you know, putting a lot of fear in people, you know. So that's why that's another part I feel like keeps people asleep too, because, you know, they don't disclose the truth of, you know, the origins of the Bible. They don't disclose, our truth, our history, where we come from. You know, we might not have originated in Africa. You know, we might be native people on this soil, because African people were native of this land as well. So, you know, a lot of things that we learned growing up, you know, is their story, you know. And that if you don't know where you come from, a lot of times you can't really navigate where you're going. So
that is true. And some of the younger generation are more awakened than the younger generation, because I have some of them, they drop some history on me, and I'm like, wow, how do you know that? They actually, you know, they get on the computer and they do their research, and they kind of, some of them don't take everything for face value. They're asking questions, which is good. You have to always be seeking higher knowledge from some, you know, from somewhere. So all of them aren't caught up in, you know, Lil Wayne and things. Some of them awaken their self, which is great.
And that's wonderful. And we need more people like Brother Steve, you know, Brother Ali. We need more of these people with this knowledge so we can bring it to the youth, so we can bring it to our communities. You know, because people aren't going to stay asleep much longer. I mean, there's no time to, you know, the time is now. But we, like, you know, we can't force people to do things. So everybody is pretty much on the level that they need to be on, running the race. You know, we're, nobody is more of ahead or behind. It's just that we have to be comfortable in our own skin, you know, not to force our views on other people. And just, you know, be able to agree to disagree and still hold love for each other at the end of the day. Because that's ultimately what it's all about. It's no right, it's no wrong, it's no pointing the finger and all it is. It's just vibrating to love. And I know this just seems so corny, because like, oh, yeah, let's vibrate to love. Everything, but we know everything isn't peachy, but we're down here for an experience, whether it's good or whether it's bad. We're here to experience it. So, you know, when you think about, like I was saying earlier, when you want to get caught up in the right and the wrong of everything, even you can go back to the Bible where it talks about forgiving others. You must forgive everybody of their sin. You know, I feel like the word sin is a man-made word, because what is a sinner? Somebody that does bad. By whose standards? Your standards? What's bad? You know, and then at the end of the day, you say, forgive me anyway, so nobody was ever at fault. You know, you were just having your experience. If I'm forgiving you for any and everything you've done, whether you raped, killed, or murdered, stole, whatever, I'm forgiving you. And I tell you right there that nobody is at fault for the actions. It's just part of the experience as human beings down here that we're acting out. And so everything is pretty much, everything is the same. It's all under the same umbrella. We all come from, you know, the source. Some might beg the difference. Some say we come from other entities and things like that. But for me, ultimately, it's got to be the one source somewhere. You know what I'm saying? You know,
they created the
ones that could have created us. You know, we don't know, you know. So, and that's why I say, like, here we're here still learning. We don't know everything, and we never will know everything. But to learn, and if somebody calls the show and they have something they want to tell us, and that we never heard or that we have heard of, we take that, and if it resonates with us, then, you know, so be it. But we aren't the type of people that just impose our opinion on you, or we're not looking for you to think we know everything. That's what I wanted to get out there. So, because we're all students, we're on this planet for life.
That makes a lot of sense, because what resonates with some may not resonate with others. So it's like wherever you're at on your journey, if it feels good to you, I love it. You know, I'm saying.
And it's
what
all
anybody
the same, you know.
Is doing, because
I can humble myself and go to a, you know, a church with somebody and whatever. I can humble myself and go to a mosque. I mean, because to me, we're all under, it's all the same. We're not separated, you know. So we're just trying to love each other like we would love, love ourselves. So at the end of the day, we always have to put love first, you know. And our intent, is our intent coming from a place of love, or are we being it's all about balance.
That's true. Okay. You have to just meet people where they are. I can remember, I guess it was probably sometime last year, and I kind of got into a debate with my father-in-law. He was, I guess he still is a part of, Jehovah's Witness religion, but he doesn't go anymore, and he was, trying to tell me things, and I pushed deeper. Anything he said, I would answer back with the question. And he was like, well, you know them by their fruits. I said, okay, so do I bear bad fruit? And he was like, well, no. I was like, okay, then, well, how is that, that one statement relevant? Just because somebody's not a part of one organization does not mean that they are bad or, good. And I was like, you just shouldn't judge people because of that. So I got him a little bit. I got him thinking, I could tell. But, I try not to let the ego get involved. But sometimes, you're just like, come on, stop judging people. Stop trying to, make people, believe what's right for you. And you're still doing what your religion is telling you not to do. So it's just like, you just seem like.
Thank you. That's all I was going to say. People can't. I'm not going to say most people. No one can walk that walk 100%. That's my whole thing. Nobody can walk that walk 100%. You are doing something in your book that tells you not to do it, but yet you still point your finger at other people. Stop that. Please stop that. Because you're in violation of your own morals and values when you do that. That's self-righteousness. That's judgment. And we can't judge others. We have to come from a higher place, a higher perspective of being neutral, because spirit is neutral. Spirit doesn't judge us.
Mm-hmm.
No spirit, so we have to elevate.
we have to elevate ourselves.
And, that's the thing. Instead of pointing a finger, work on yourself.
Mm-hmm. No judgment, all love zone. That should be, maybe we'll do a hashtag with that. No judgment, all love.
Right.
Put it out there in the world.
Okay.
Well, I guess that was our introductory rant, but which is definitely needed sometimes. So without further ado, I would like to introduce our guest, Mr. Steve Johnson, author of the book, How Did I Get Here? From a Kushite to a Thug. Mr. Steve, Brother Steve, hello, hello, hello. This thing is searching. Come on, come on. It's like the little time clock is going around and around in a circle.
Oh, is he on?
He's on the line. Give me, hold on 1 second. Technology. Let me see if I can refresh. Let me refresh the page to get him. On the line. You can keep talking, Miss Sick Feather.
Okay, I just want to give a shout out to Sister Isis. She gave me a spiritual reading, and it was on point. I recommend you all get you one just to see what's going on. Christians call them prophets and seers. Sinners might call them psychics. So, But all in all, if someone has this third eye, or their psychic senses on deck. So, but I just wanted to give her a shout out because, I was she gave me some information, and I kept stalling on it, and it finally got taken care of, and I just wanted to thank her for that wisdom, and just give a shout out to all the goddesses, and the goddesses that were on the show, Mama O and Avarisha. Just want to give a shout out to you ladies.
Thank you, ladies. All right, I think we're ready to go, Mr. I don't know why I say Mr. Let me get out the workplace. Brother Johnson, are you on the line? Brother Steve.
I am here. Oh, tip, sisters, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, we can hear you.
Good, good. Peace, sisters. I'm glad to be here with y'all.
Pleasure's all ours.
Yeah,
okay, Brother Steve, let's get into it.
Something.
Yes, yes. Let's get into it. Tonight's topic is about melanin, and Brother Steve is bringing his gifts and jewels of knowledge and to enlighten you all and get you all aware and to demystify a lot of things that you might not understand that's going on with you if you are a newcomer into your awakening, into the awakening of yourself. So without further ado, Brother Steve, you can get into it.
Well, sisters, I want to first say it's a beautiful thing what you sisters are doing with your show. I've been listening to y'all for you know, the last couple of weeks, and I think the information you guys, you sisters are bringing forth is much needed in the community. I heard a sister say earlier, no one knows it all, and I couldn't have said that better. You know, we all are in one way or another in search of knowledge, you know.
Yes.
We continue with search, you know. You never get enough.
I know, and it's a beautiful journey. I'm like, I feel more free and liberated now than I ever have.
Yes.
True.
Right. Definitely a fun journey.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Powerful journey. Blessed to be on this journey, you know. So many of our people are asleep, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's our duty to help them, wake them up in any way we can.
Yes. That's why we're healing messengers, you know, as part of our journey. So we embrace it and, you know, we just press forward. Whoever want to get on the train, hop on.
I hear you.
That's how I feel.
Yeah, but we on melanin today, so, you know.
Yeah.
How y'all want to talk about it first? What you want to get into? It's a very deep subject. Deep subject, melanin.
Yes. Well, first, let's, can you demystify? What it is?
Okay, yeah. Well, basically, for those that are out there that don't know what melanin is, to make it plain, because it's a very heavy subject. It's a difference on what melanin is and what it does. Melanin basically is, to make it simple, it's a conductor of electromagnetic frequencies, y'all, that allows a person, you know, mankind, a human being, to be able to pull, retain, and deliver heat correctly. It's in almost every organ of the body. One of the first things I started studying when I became conscious was melanin, because, you know, I would hear it all the time from my elders, you know, just about the melanin that's in our skin. I didn't understand the whole dynamics of it. So I, you know, became curious, you know, why we are able to stay out in the sun longer than some races, you know, where we could withstand certain things that other races couldn't. And that, you know, was very curious. And I started to dig and, you know, came across some real powerful scholars. Dr. Africa is one of them. Dr. Carol Barnes, who a lot of people might not be familiar with, but he's one of the, you know, pioneers in this field. And he's a brother, Carol Barnes, if those want to go look him up. But melanin basically is a conductor of electromagnetic frequencies. It's basically necessary for our brains to operate. Without melanin, we would be in a state of mental retardation. And as you see, a lot of our people who, you know, aren't using their melanin correctly or have, low levels of melanin, I'll say it like that, you can see some, you know, behavior that displays similarities to mental illness, right? It's necessary for the brain to operate. It's necessary for us to be able to see, and most importantly, it's necessary for us to reproduce. It's basically the chemical key to life. It covers the egg in a woman's body as well as sperm. It comes in many different forms, including gas, liquid, as well as a crystal. We understand melanin primarily through what you sisters mentioned, the third eye. Europeans gave it the name the pineal gland. Now this gland, basically, which is in our brain, secretes a hormone known as melatonin at night. Now, I want to get this out the way because a lot of people say, okay, you know, white people don't have melanin, and that's not necessarily true. They have a different kind of melanin. I always talk about a study I read a few years ago about during the Vietnam War when the soldiers were dying, and they were doing autopsies on the soldiers' bodies, and they were opening up their brains, and they were looking at the convolutions of their brain, and they were saying they were seeing in the African, the brother brains, that the part of the brain that we now know as the pineal gland was like it was ripe. It looked like grape. It was like a connected. It was solid. It looked like it was, you know, working. And when they were opening up the Europeans' brains, they were seeing that their pineal gland was calcified. So that forced the Europeans to start studying, what does this do for us? What is it, you know? And then when you see, you know, the actions and the behavior of some Europeans, you can understand why, you know, you can understand how they came up with that. Basically, what I'm saying is that most Europeans' pineal glands are calcified. Most people of African descent is not. It's the difference between, like, a grape and a raisin, all right, to make it plain. Look at a grape and you look at a raisin, right? It's the same thing, but one's dead, one's not, right? So, and that's basically the difference. There's also other differences. For instance, blacks have what we call selenium at the core of their melanin, and whites have sulfur. So that's another huge difference when you're understanding
sulfur?
What it is. Yes, they have sulfur in their pineal gland, which says a lot.
it says a
heck of a lot. Now, when you look at, and I don't want to be too long-winded, but when you look at melanin, you have to understand what scientists call free radicals or charged particles, right? They call these things charged particles. They're inside of our bodies because of our metabolism, right? Now, the body tries to trap and get rid of it. But if your melanin is not working right, you're not going to be able to get rid of these free radicals or these charged particles, which we now know we get through TV, computer screens, cell phones. I mean, it's all around us every single day. Not one of us could escape the fact that these charged particles are entering our bodies. Now, the thing with melanin is melanin neutralizes these free radicals, sisters, right?
Wow.
It neutralizes these free radicals, and it either holds it so that the body could use it for energy, or it gets rid of it. It gets rid of it, right? Or it puts it in a part of a body where it could be used, right? So these free radicals could be used correctly if your melanin is right. You know, so that's a very, very, very important point. So, you know, for us to understand, like, basically, if your melanin is messed up, you're going to have problems, right?
Wow.
Your organs will not be able to function right if your melanin is not right. And we'll get into how you get your melanin right in a second. But to understand it, initially, we need to understand that your heart, your lungs, your liver, as well as your sex organs, brothers and sisters. Now, I know a lot of our people get, you know, we're interested in that. You know, this whole ED thing. This thing starts with melanin, right? If your melanin is not right, you're going to have some problems, okay? Now, melanin affects your motivation, your dreaming. It prevents cancer. It affects your movements, emotions, memory, as well as anti-aging. You know, when they say the black don't crack, that's what that is. That's melanin. You know, as a kid, I used to see my grandmother going to bed at 8 o'clock. I said, man, why is she going to bed? And, you know, I would call her sometimes and, you know, try to borrow a couple bucks. I said, girl, you know, she would cuss me out if I called her after 8 o'clock. Now, she understood she needed to get that rest, right?
Right.
She didn't understand melanin, right, because we now understand through science and technology that melanin secretes from this pineal gland at a certain time of the day. In the summertime, it secretes from nine, the highest point from 9 until about 12 o'clock at night. You have to, it has to be dark. You have to be at peace so that it's like an IV. It secretes through your body and gives you all these different things that I just mentioned. Again, the motivation, the dreaming, you know, the cancer prevention, the anti-aging. You get all this from that correct secretion. Now, if you're awoke at that time, it's still going to secrete, but it's not going to secrete at the level that you need to replenish your body. It's, all it is a good night's rest. You get a good night's rest, you feel better the next day. That's melanin. And it's working. And it's scary because when you look at our youth today, how many's going to bed at 9 o'clock? They put the good shows on it, the shows that they call good, after 9 o'clock, right? What time's love and hip-hop come on? After 9. That's what our people's watching, right?
Love
and hip-hop, all these crazy shows. So that's important for us to understand that it secretes during a certain time. And if you're not asleep and it's not quiet and you're not in a place of peace, it won't secrete right. Serotonin is the other hormone that secretes during the day, and that's a whole other subject. That secretes from the pineal gland during the day, and that gives us a different set of you know, things that help us through life. Melanin, again, brothers and sisters, is basically a conductor of electromagnetic frequencies that is all around us every single day. And in order to correctly use it, we have to have the correct amount of melanin, right? Now, a lot of people, you know, get upset when you start talking about white people have melanin too. They do. It's just not being used correctly, you know. And as I mentioned, they have different mood swings. Different things happen to their brain because they're not able to use it right. Now, what melanin does is different, sisters. It basically, initially, it helps us make energy by losing less energy. The scientists call it conversion reaction. That's what they call that. And it helps us make energy by using less energy. And those that have higher levels of melanin, you're able to do that better. I explained to the young brothers, this is why LeBron James jumped so high. I guarantee you, that brother has high levels of melanin. As a child, when I played sports, you know, I'm 6'5" now, but as a child, I would think something and do it. I would think, jump up 12 feet in the air and dunk that ball, and I did it. Without a hesitation.
It was easy to do.
It was easy. It was nothing to it. It just, I don't know, it was like almost flying.
Yeah.
You know? And when we talk about our ancestors back in the day with these gifts they had, I guarantee you, they had high levels of melanin.
Yes.
Super high levels of melanin, you know? It also controls puberty. It allows for us to have superior senses. You know, outside of the main senses we understand, sight, taste, smell, touch, sound, you know, allows us to have superior senses. It helps us produce vitamin D, which is huge. Huge. Protected from the sunlight, as everybody understands. It controls puberty. Another big thing. It controls puberty. It helps us store information. So melanin is powerful. It's one of the most powerful things that we could ever talk about and ever understand. The thing about it is that, you know, we're not taught about it young enough in order to allow ourselves to use it correctly so that we can have a good life. This is why black men are dying in their 50s, you know, in the early 60s, because we're not taking care of our bodies, not eating the right foods, not sleeping at the right times, you know. Working an overnight job is almost like committing suicide. Being awake every night at night, is you are killing yourself. You must sleep during the hours when this melanin is secreting from your pineal glands.
And can you give that time again?
9 p.m. is the main time where it starts to secrete. Again, it's like an IV, like it drips, and it just flows through your body as you as you rest. You know, so you know, we have to understand that we need to get the proper rest, and we need to eat the right foods.
And not use toothpaste with fluoride.
Yeah, fluoride is bad for you. Fluoride is bad. Yeah, that'll kill you. There's so many different things out here, sisters, that are harming us on a daily basis. You know, it's almost impossible to stay away from everything. You know, the chemtrails in the air, the water, the manganese they're putting in the water, the phthalates in the plastic. Brothers and sisters, there's a chemical called phthalates that they make, that they put plastic together with. The European Union just voted and said, you know what, we are outlawing phthalates in plastics. You no longer are allowed to use it. Do you think America would do that? Heck no, because they got to recall everything, because it's in everything. It's in your car steering wheel. It's in your shower curtain. And this phthalate chemical is causing ADHD, heart attack, all kinds of different things. Please go look it up. It's spelled with a P, phthalate.
Brother Steve, how is this legal? Yes.
Well, it's not legal, you know. But see, America, you know, we're in a capitalist system, and all they care about is money. So to have to recall everything that they've used, you know, this chemical in, man, we'd have to recall everything, you know, or you know, a writing pen that we use and we touch it every single day. We pick it up and we write with it. That probably has phthalates in it. The only company that I've found in America right now that doesn't use phthalates is St. Ives. If you've heard of St. Ives, they have the soap, the lotion, and they have other dangerous chemicals in there, but they don't use phthalates in their plastic.
Yes.
So, you know, you think you're drinking some good water, and that water been sitting for 6 months, that phthalate then creeped into the water. Let's believe that.
Oh, God.
So, you know, not to get off subject, but this is some serious stuff we're dealing with.
Yes.
Yeah, it's all related, you know. So
yes, it is.
Feel free to rant on about it. Goodness,
it is. You know what? Well, you know, and I have sisters. You sisters on the line, and I, you know, melanin directly how it affects you all is when you look at the skin, right? There's three layers that we have with our skin. The first layer, they call endoderm, E-N-D-O-D-E-R-M. The second layer is the mesoderm. And then the third layer, the outer layer, is called an ectoderm. Now, in this layer, they have recently, the studies show that they found melanin in that layer. They found melanin. And they also found recently, through our great scholars, I've been able to break down that every fetus that is created has a layer of melanin around it. Every fetus has a melanin layer. Now, if your melanin is not working right, right? Okay. And your baby doesn't have that correct protective layer of melanin. Most likely you're going to abort that baby. Something's going to happen where that baby's not going to have the correct amount of energy it needs to grow. Now, when you look at that ectoderm, as I mentioned, that ectoderm layer forms our brain and our spinal cord, sisters.
Wow.
Let me say that again. That ectoderm forms the brain and the spinal cord. So without that, again, that melanin layer, you can't form a brain or a spinal cord. Therefore, you will die. That baby will abort. So melanin, I'm telling you, it's much more than just skin. It's much more. And when we look at our people, we have what Dr. Africa calls a messed up melanin, right? He explains that messed up melanin is killing melanated people. Now, what does he mean by that? He's saying that by the food that we are eating, the bad sleeping habits, and also the drugs that we use destroy melanin, legal and illegal drugs. Now, not cocaine, hallucinogens, sedatives, herbicides, nicotine, and caffeine, all right? Something that I've used to drink all the time, coffee. When I found out this information, I ain't drink no coffee since. I drink some tea, but nicotine and caffeine combined destroys your melanin almost more than not sleeping.
Oh, wow.
That's the very serious thing. Diet is serious.
Yeah.
Now, there are things that we could eat that can help us produce melanin. Things like raw peanuts, ginkgo, blackberry, dandelion root, figs, strawberries, mangoes, olives, apples, soy milk, different things that we can eat that will help us produce this melanin.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Okay.
So, you know, understanding is key. You know, knowledge is key.
Yes, knowledge.
I have to share this with our people so we can, you know, get this out there so that our people can understand how to take care of their bodies better. You know, how do we get this melanin at a high level? And again, when you see a good brother that's taking care of his body and he's 60 years old, he might look 35.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You wonder, what is his secret? What is this dude doing? You know, what's this sister doing to look this good at 60?
Right.
She doesn't have to, you know, she might not even know melanin. She just might be taking care of her body.
Right,
sleeping
right,
eating right, you know?
After someone is doing all of those things, eating right, exercising, working out,
Mm-hmm.
Is it still possible for that melanin not to be working properly?
Yes, if you are on some type of drugs, or
okay.
if you, you know, because all disease is disease. That's all.
Mm-hmm.
Everything starts with the mind. You know,
uh-huh.
if your mind's
uh-huh.
messed up, if you're a mean person, you're mean spirited, you can throw the melanin off.
Uh-huh.
You can throw it off.
Uh-huh.
You could be putting stuff in your system that the melanin is saying, "What the heck is this, man? I don't know what are you putting. What are you doing?" Which will throw it the process off.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Now, what
so
do you think about like rap music or
oh,
car
oh,
movies and things
oh,
like that?
Yeah.
How does that influence melanin? Because
I just
saw a study where they said that rap music. They've been doing a study on rap music, and they said that it's been helping people with mental illness. Now, I don't know if that's something they're putting out there
mm-hmm.
to, you know, work against us, or, I mean, how do you feel about that?
I think there's some truth to that. When you look at us, specifically
uh-huh.
people of African descent or whatever you want to call us,
uh-huh.
Sounds affect us different than it does other people. For
yeah.
instance, low bass sounds are good for African people.
Mm-hmm.
High sounds are not. So when you look at the beat, which is primarily what draws you into a bull crap rap song, you know,
mm-hmm.
the beat draws
mm-hmm.
you in. Most of the time, you don't hear what the heck they're saying. You caught up into the beat, and you know, you're like, what the heck did I do say? You know, like the new song, they got Lifestyle, you know, with the Young Thug.
Yeah.
And dude, I'm thinking,
I
think that's
I feel so guilty.
You know, you know what I'm saying? I know the words. You understand? I ain't too far. I'm from the rap generation. I'm still in my 30s, so I know what it is. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And, but the beat grabs you first. It grabs you.
Mm-hmm.
Then you're
mm-hmm.
like, oh, what the heck is this dude saying?
Like, what's
so,
this?
You know,
uh-oh.
Yeah. So low bass sounds awaken the what's called electrocytes in the black cell, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, the
mm-hmm.
black cell is basically the battery that turns this melanin on. Now, when you
wow.
look at it, the black cell is made up of three components. It's the first component is called the melanosum,
mm-hmm.
melanin, and the melanocyte, right? And
okay.
these three components together make up this black cell. Now, there are other things that help turn this black cell on. Like, it's almost like a battery. Right?
Mm-hmm,
it's
mm-hmm,
like a battery
mm-hmm.
to make the cell work. Terazine, melanin, copper, these different things work in a system to, like a battery, to turn
mm-hmm.
this melanin cell on, right? Because basically
okay.
it's a carbon system, right?
Okay, yeah.
Carbon system. And it has more, melanin has more than one way that it's manufactured and that it functions. That's another point that we have to understand.
Okay. So is this why drumming and is important.
Yes.
I mean,
yes. Drumming can help. Yes.
Because, you know, as soon as we hear, it's like, can I help? What to move? It's like, what is this?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, okay, so that has a lot, that's a major part in, even in church, when the choir gets to playing and rhythmic beat and people start catching the spirit and all of that, that's,
yes.
that's the same connection, right?
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yes, it
okay.
is. And we just don't clearly understand it, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we've been doing that since the beginning of time, you know, as far as, you know, the low bass sounds and different things like that. You know, I've seen an experiment recently where a brother placed some sand on the top
mm-hmm.
of a speaker, and he played rock and roll music. It didn't do anything. He played rap. It didn't do anything. He played
mm-hmm.
jazz with a low beat, some Miles Davis. The
mm-hmm.
sand turned into a star.
Whoa. There it is, people. There it is. I think I've seen something similar to that, but they were, they had salt on the speaker. And,
mm-hmm.
but I think they were playing classical music or something, but it did change the symmetry of the sand.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, is electricity related to activation of melanin in any way?
Somewhat. You know, we are basically walking electricity.
Mm-hmm,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So we are a conductor, as I mentioned, a conductor of these electromagnetic frequencies that are all around us, invisible frequencies that we can't see, but that affect our mood, you know. It'll affect how we feel that day, you know. So, again, if your melanin is not right and you're receiving these frequencies, which we can't get away from, it's impossible, especially living in this country, because all around us, you know, are frequencies that are just you know, that are basically trying to eat us away. And if we don't have the proper melanin to be able to catch it, use it the right way, or get rid of it, it's just going to break you down. And next thing you know, you're going to have all kinds of issues with your organs in your body.
Now, if somebody is, you know, just coming into this and they're like, well, you know, how would I activate my melanin? If, say, for instance, you know, we have the elements and everything working against us, what would be the first thing you would tell somebody that they can do to, you know, get their melanin back and working?
Get rid of your microwaves.
You know what? My microwave broke
a few months ago. Throw the microwave in the trash. And limit the amount of time you sit in front of your computer screens or have your phone connected to your body, like in your pocket or on your face, right? Limit, you know, the amount of frequencies, you know, as much as possible. Because, again, it's almost impossible to get rid of it. I mean, you know, just sitting there with the television on, you're receiving frequencies. Walking out the house, there's so many in the air. We've destroyed nature so much that it's almost impossible to get away from it. So do what you can in the presence of your own home to eliminate the things that are causing high levels of free radicals, these charged particles, as I mentioned. And one of the first things I would say is a microwave. You know,
okay.
Using these microwaves and nuke your food, and you know, you don't know you're standing there, and that frequency's hitting you too.
Right. Now, do you know the radiation? How is that connected to the melanin? Because I read somewhere that I don't know if it transmute the radiation or does it convert the. It's something I read about radiation and melanin.
Yes.
Yeah,
it's basically the, you know, the same thing. You know, any type of frequency of energy. For instance, I just read about a month ago, I was doing research, and I've been consistently, you know, researching melanin over the last 8 years. And one of the things I came across was, and it startled me, and I haven't found any evidence to support this brother's claim, but I read that AIDS can't exist in the presence of melanin.
Whoa.
Nothing. Cancer can't. If you have the right amounts of melanin, it'll get rid of anything negative in your body, one way or another, including radiation.
Radiation.
When you know, I heard a doctor once say on a show I was watching, and he was talking about this thing that they call junk DNA. Now, basically, and I said, what's this dude talking about? I said, let me, what's this dude talking about? So I went and looked, and they're finding primarily in people of African descent, again, when we pass transition, the bottom of our kidneys and our lungs are black powdered substance.
What?
Melanin.
What?
Because the melanin just drops into the bottom of these two organs.
Dang.
And it becomes substance. And they're calling it junk DNA. Why junk DNA? Because they don't want to know. Meanwhile, they're making pills, melatonin this, melatonin that.
Will you please,
you know,
go into
every
this melatonin day. Pill thing because...
They understand us better than we do. They know the power in melanin. That's why they want to be us. That's why they're doing everything they can to try to get up to the level where we are. And we so busy destroying it. They use it for sleeping aid. That's their smoke screen, right? They give us that. Oh, well, you're just using it to take. No. They understand the internal aspects of what it does for a person's body, and they've been trying to make these pills for years. I mean, years. Trying to figure out how do we get this level of melanin? How can we stop us from catching these different cancers? Right? These different skin cancers, these internal cancers. How are these black people able to survive the sun and we're not? What's going on? Like, why are we burning and dying and they can stand out there all single all day? So, you know, that started their search to figure out how to do it. They understand clearly, sister. I'm telling you, as I mentioned in the Vietnam War, they started to say, hold up, something ain't right. Why is our gland look calcified and theirs look normal?
Yeah. And I don't know.
What is Hello. Yeah, I just was, what, okay, the melatonin pills, because I've taken those before when I was having trouble sleeping. So what is in them? This is before, you know, I was awakened to a lot of things. What is actually in, you know, the pills?
Yeah, synthetic material. Dopamine is one of the things that you know, they've created to, you know, and dopamine, you know, helps us not only with sleeping, but with our sex drive. So there's a bunch of synthetic, you know, things that are inside that melanin and that they've tried to copy through tests and studies and different things like that. But they can't do what nature does, right? You can't copy something that nature's made. You know, we're living in a society that spends more money on promoting a pill, promoting a drug, as opposed to researching what the heck is doing to my body. They ain't even telling us what's in half of these pills, sister.
Yeah, and people popping them like candy
because they say it's good. I mean, they got a pill for everything. Your knee hurt, here, take this. Your back hurt, take this. You can't see, here, take this, you know. And they're not telling us what's in this, what's going to happen as a result of me taking this, you know.
Right. And we put our trust and faith so much in doctors,
oh, yeah,
you know.
Oh, yeah, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And even a lot of times doctors shy away from introducing this information to us. You know, I remember when my son was being born and, you know, I had a chance to sit down and conversate with the doctor. And he looked at me like, what med school you go to? I said, dude, I ain't in a med school. I just do a lot of reading, man.
Right.
I was blown away, almost like, man, how does this nigger know this information?
Yeah.
You know? And I'm asking, man, hey, man, what's this? Now, that's melanin, right? All fetuses are female, right? He said, how'd you know that? I said, yes, sir.
So I opened the book, Steve. That's how.
And they don't want us to know this.
Steve, I don't know if you heard this, but, you know, a long time ago I was listening to Brother Bobby Hemmett talking about when he
powerful
came to visit.
Brother.
Yes, yes. When he came to D.C., he said, someone had picked him up from the airport, and this guy happened to be like a chauffeur for, I guess, like the dead people, you know, transporting them. And he was telling them that, you know, they're all, you know, because back in the 80s, D.C. was like, had the biggest crime rate, had the biggest murder rate. And black people were dying at an alarming rate. And he was saying that they were taking specifically all blacks. For some reason, the males especially, but they were requesting the pineal glands only, and they were transporting them. And I also had read recently where the scientists have been doing studies with black aborted baby cells or something. They're trying to create a solar cell or something.
Sister. Wow, and I'm too. Oh, beautiful. You are beautiful, sister, just for understanding that. Man, you're touching my heart right now. Look, when you talk about black aborted babies, you drink a Pepsi, you're drinking black aborted babies. They put in what's called bromine. Bromine is a chemical that they've created from aborted babies inside all kinds of products. Nestle, Kraft, Pepsi, all these major companies are using our parts. Right, and not telling us. This is a scary thing. You know, in this country, if a product has less than 2% of a chemical, they ain't got to tell you it's in there.
And
there's a law right now. They put whatever in there, whatever. You know, and it all boils down to, sister, basically understand that melanin is the best molecule in the body. It's the key to memory and all knowledge. It's our internal computer. It's our internal computer. And if it's off, your computer ain't working right, you ain't logging on, you can't get online, that thing going to shut off on you, and you're going to see a black screen. That's the same thing that happens internally with our bodies.
Now, do you think this is any connection to a lot of missing black people?
Yes.
People that are going missing?
Yes, without a doubt. Without a doubt.
Because
they studied us, sister. They studied us. They've been studying us for a very, 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 very long time. You know, when you look at European scholars like Howard Zinn or who is more recent, who wrote the book People's History of the United States, you can see through his research, and he's one of the few white scholars I even mentioned, okay, because he at least was halfway honest. He admitted that they were weren't superior to us, that we had a superiority about us if we were able to use our melanin correctly, right?
Right.
And he understood that.
What was his name again?
He kept it real. Howard Zinn was his name. He passed away a few years ago. He wrote the book People's History of the United States. And in his book, by the way, he also said that when poor whites realized he was in the same boat with blacks, they started uniting. And the powers that be said, oh, heck no, we can't have that. So that's where we get this whole 40 acres and a mule thing. They lied to both sides. They said, we're going to give y'all both 40 acres and a mule. Stop. Both of y'all shut up. We won't overthrow the government. We're going to give y'all, but by the way, they got it. We didn't. That's where Spike Lee got his company, 40 acres and a mule from.
Mm.
You got to understand history. You got to read. You know, I teach youth classes with young brothers, and they say to me all the time, what's this, man? This ain't important to me, man. What you talking, Brother Steve? Is this going to help me get a Lamborghini? You know, how am I going to eat off this? And I said, brother, this is the key to your survival.
Yes.
Ain't got nothing to do with no coat, no clothes, no True Religion jeans, or none of that. Right? And it really is really sad to see how our people, you know, I heard my man Nas in one of the songs. He said, when you feed people the truth, you never know how they're going to react. That is so true. That's so true. Tell a sister something, you know, you never know if she's going to take it or not. You know, it just takes sisters and brothers like ourselves to just keep giving it to them. So what? You don't want to listen? Keep giving it to them. Keep giving it to them. And a lot of our people are mentally ill, right?
Yeah.
Another power point that's going to shock a lot of people is that a lack of melanin causes schizophrenia.
Yes, and that's very prevalent in our community.
Schizophrenia is caused by lack of melanin. That is the number one cause of schizophrenia right now.
Yes.
Come on, sisters. It's on the rise
because I work in the school system, and it just boggles me at the children, particularly black males who are labeled ED, emotionally disturbed, and it's like, when you talk to them, it's like they're not disturbed. It's just, you know, it's just society kind of, you know, what's going on mostly in their home. And a lot of children, they carry the burdens of their parents. You have teenagers who they get up, they have to fix their sibling breakfast, they have to get them dressed, ready, walk them to school, then walk themselves to school. And you're wondering, and, you know, the administrators are getting you late every day, you're late, but you don't see... You don't really see what they're going through at home. They have to cook. Right. I remember having a student who was like, I need to call my mom. And it's like, well, what do you need to call her for? He was like, I have to remind her to take the chicken out. So they're like, huh? So he called her and he's like, Mom, I need you to take the chicken out the freezer, put it in the sink, run the water over it. And she was like, okay. And she's like, okay, where's my food stamp card? And he was like, I gave it back to you. I wrapped a receipt around it and put it on your dresser. You know, and it's like, wow.
Yeah.
And he's like running the household, and he had like four younger siblings. So it's like, I think I would be a little disturbed too, you know, if I was 14 years old and basically I'm I'm playing the father role.
So
you know, it's just, it's a lot. It's a lot,
it's
but
a lot.
Wow, this is just, this is amazing.
It is. And Brother Steve, what I wanted to know, could you touch a little bit more on the solar cell, how that relates to the sun and melanin and this new cell that they're trying to, that they are producing, the solar cell from the black aborted babies?
From my understanding,
called a solar cell because of the sun.
From my understanding, they've had a lot of trouble producing that. Their trials haven't went as well as they would like. The first thing in understanding the solar cell, what they call the solar cell, is to understand that the universe is made up of melanin. Right? The universe is black. When you look at space, space is black.
Right.
Is made up of melanin. So, you know, when they figured that out, they said, okay, how do we, you know, what could we do to create this? And again, you know, to sum that up and to make it plain for the people to understand is we have people who are trying to imitate nature, and they will never be able to do that. There are things that nature does and for our bodies, for the universe, that we just are not going to be able to understand. Right? We try, but even with as much technology as we have, but we're not going to be able to. Our ancestors were at a higher level of understanding that than we are with all this technology.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. There's so many examples of that. Look at the Dogon. They were able to do certain things that we still can't do to this day.
Right. They're so fascinating.
So it's,
they had an understanding of the binary codes that the computer runs.
Yes, they did. They did.
I mean, amazing
stuff. They had crystals that, you know, that they could, you know, how were they able to see the Sirius star system, you know, thousands of years ago? They have no telescope.
Right.
They had melanin crystals. So, I looked at the story of Atlantis, and, you know, most scholars believe it's a mythological and allegory, right? But when you look at Atlantis and how, you know, they said that the people were able to fly, and how there were 7 foot people. There were women that were 7 foot that never had a period, and different things like that. You know,
wow,
wow. How did this society fall? Most scholars agree, you know, that the as far as what the story was told, that Atlantis fell and it sunk, and it, you know, basically they believe it's in the bottom of the ocean. It sunk because people were ignorant to will. They didn't understand that they were causing the problems themselves. They started to blame it, oh, well, it's Earth, it's, you know, it's God, it's the devil, it's, you know, but not themselves. And that's the same thing that's happening to us today.
Yes,
we are ignoring
yes.
that we are the ones that are destroying nature. We're doing these things, and we don't fix it. We wind up at the bottom of the damn ocean just like they did. Simple
as that. Is that because does the Earth recycle itself? You know, during certain, you know, after certain.
Yeah, I believe it does. I believe it does. They have a term that they call precession, which basically defines how the Earth rotates on its axis. And that's what the Europeans label it as. Every 6,000 years, I believe it is, the Earth rotates on its axis. I believe precession has a lot to do with what we were just talking about. The Earth saying, you know what, it's time to get rid of some things. It's time to keep it, right? And let's get rid of it. You know, in different ways, if you look at history, you can see the Earth reacting to, you know, a certain thing that was going on at the time, and it put a stop to it. We could look at that Ice Age as an example, particularly the Worm Ice Age, which helped produce the European race. Right, where they got stuck across what they now call that 51st parallel. Dr. Kaba talks about this a lot, where these Grimaldi Africans left Africa and they got stuck in the Ice Age and they started to turn color. Their eyes was the first thing that turned, and you know that you know the eyes has a lot to do with melanin, right? In your retina, there's a layer of melanin. That's one of the first things that change your eye color. When you don't get melanin, your eye color is going to change first. Is why we got Europeans with all these different colors eyes, right? Because they have lack of melanin, period.
Wow. And it's amazing how light eyes are so coveted. I don't know if you've seen the rapper T.I.'s wife, but she changed her eye color to a receptive color. Yeah, like an ice blue gray. And she set her own self back. It's like, you know, you just don't know what you had, and you just changed it, you know.
Well, she comes from a European woman, so, you know, let's keep it real. You know, she's, you know, a lot of people, you know, I say this correctly, and I don't mean any disrespect. I have white friends that I, you know, associate with, that I communicate. But, you know, when we look at that, you know, look at the culture she was raised in. A lot of us want to be the best white person we could be. I'm serious. We want to be the best white person we could be. You can tell by the way we dress, by the way we talk, you know, how we want to, you know, run away from the hood, not get back, you know.
And why do we always have to conform to their standards? It's like, we can't just be ourselves. It's like, well,
I want to be myself. I don't care. But I'm just saying, you know, we're used to straightening up, talking different. Mm-hmm. When we get in their presence, they don't do that for us, you know.
Look at what we do to our hair. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Do it to our hair. And that's the first thing that, you know, we talk about the nine ether, you know, and how our hair grows straight up and theirs grow to the side or down. Right?
Oh,
they ain't been able to use that energy right like we are. But what we doing? Cut every chance we get. Perming every chance we get. Flat. You know, and I ain't got nothing against the sisters that, you know, do what they do. I'm just saying, you know, scientifically, genetically, you ain't supposed to do that.
We were talking about this earlier today. That's why we were laughing.
Look. All right now, Brother Steve, because look, I like a flat iron every now and then.
Do your thing, sister.
Look. I will rock a weave in a minute, honey.
I hear you.
My sister's conscious as anybody else and say,
That's right. But hey, sister, ain't nothing wrong with it, but you know who you are.
We keep it natural today, right.
You know who you are, you know. Every now and then, let that thing grow. You know, you do what you want to. But I guarantee you, nature at some point going to pop out. You're going to flatten it, you know, let it get wet. Nature going to come right back.
Oh, yeah, right now. Right now, it's a curly ponytail. It's a situation, you know.
Right. And our hair grows into a nine, you know, which gives us a different ability to be able to, you know, grab that sunlight, use it the right way. That's the initial stages of melanin, our hair.
Exactly. Now, can you talk about the effects of this shift that might take place in people that don't have a lot of melanin? What could possibly be the consequences?
Oh well, you're if you don't have the right kind of melanin, in one way or another, you're not going to live long. You're not going to live as long as you could. You're not going to have the life that you could possibly have.
Mm-hmm.
Again, when you look at our elders, my grandmother passed away when she was 92.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know too many people living that long, black folks today. We're dying younger, and especially with black men. You know, sisters, you sisters are living a little longer than we are, but black men, we're dying so young. I ain't talking about just no murder or, you know, none of that stuff. I'm talking about dying from physical, you know, complications, health complications, you know, kidneys, diabetes, all these different things that are popping up. You know, why ain't we had this stuff in Africa where these people was living 110 years old, still running around? 85 still having babies. No? I mean, come on.
Right.
How would they do that?
Right.
And we get ED at 40.
Even the Asian culture, they seem to live long.
Yes. Yeah. And they have levels of melanin higher than a European. You know, we go from, you know, the African on down to, you know, what we were calling a so-called Indian, Asian, and then, you know, the lowest levels of melanin. And this is the European study saying this, too. They agree to this. They have the lowest levels of melanin to any other race because their pineal gland is not working the way that it should work. It's just the way that the Creator made it. It's just the way it is. For some reason, when they mutated from us, and I'm one that believes in the polygenetic theory, and that's a whole other subject, but when they adapted, mutated from us, okay, something happened to their brain. Something clearly happened to their brain. And we now understand that their pineal gland, most of them, 80%, 60 to 80% studies show European brains are their pineal gland is calcified.
Wow. So what are they operating on? I mean,
very little. It's very little, you know. And they use other senses, other things, and that's why when you look at Sigmund Freud, who was their greatest scholar, Freud said the number two most influential traits Europeans had is that they are sexual and aggressive. He said this.
Wow.
Right? He said this. Their greatest scholar said that they are sexual and aggressive. This is the two main things that they show through their behavior from his study. Now, why are they so aggressive? Why do they do the certain things they do around the world with no conscience?
Yeah.
How are they able to move and do certain, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
you know, it all comes back to melanin. You can't oppress a people for 400 years and then blame it on them if you think it right. Come on.
That's true. Now, what about the white people that, okay, you know how you have the scholars like, Einstein. Now, mm-hmm. Do you think he had some levels of melanin, or was he more enlightened than the next man? I mean, what was it so special about him, or was he just a man that was white being highlighted because he stumbled across certain things?
Yeah, I've heard different things about him. I heard he was what they call Melungeon, which is a mixture of a whole bunch of things, including African. Okay. They said the same thing about Abraham Lincoln. So if he had a little bit of black in him, you know, they didn't highlight, they didn't tell us. Likely he did. Most likely he did. Because he don't look all the way white. No. Uh-uh. No. And when they show us certain paintings and pictures of him, you know, they distort it and change it. Because of the primitive, they try to claim everything for themselves. But and then he also, you know, if you read his story, he also took some things from other people and just took it to the next level. You know, he was one that, he was definitely a plagiarizer. He took some things and, you know, he just took it to the next level. And that's what
that seems like their nature a little bit, they go in the villages, they go to, you know, go and learn the ways of the natives when they see that it's beneficial, and then they just take it and they take it to the next level because they have the resources to do so.
With everything. Mm-hmm. Education. Mm-hmm. You know, we look at the Greek scholars. We were talking about that a little bit last time I was on the show. We look at them, for example, Herodotus, Plato, you know, Aristotle, Socrates, all these different, you know, intellectuals, as they call them, you know, in one way or another, went to Africa to study, sisters. You know, and some of them kept it real. You know, they didn't expect us to go and read it. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know, if you look at Plato, the book Republic, when you read that and you talk about his aristocracy and you're like, man, that sounds like Kemet. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
And then you go back and you look at his story and you say, hold up, man, this dude went to Africa for 20 years? Oh, hell no. he took what he learned, went back, changed it up, regurgitated it, and gave it to the people and they gave him credit. Period.
Just like they did the Bible.
So they
got the Bible from the Book of the Dead, is it?
Oh, without a doubt, the Per M. Heru, they call it. Mm-hmm. Africans call that book Per M. Heru.
Okay, flipped it, repackaged it, and resold it to us.
Resold it to us.
Here we are.
exactly what they did. And they did that in a lot of different things, a lot of different ways, you know. Well, you know, one thing we got to understand is imitation is the highest level of respect. Right, they imitated us. Right, they respected us. They loved us. They went and sat at our feet. They were blown away by the things that we can understand. Blacks were able to have brain surgery. They had salicylic acid, which is the main ingredient in aspirin, sisters. They were performing C-sections without killing the baby. These were some powerful, highly intellectual people. And they said, oh, hold up, man, where they get this? Please teach me. But see, the thing with them is, they didn't correctly understand a lot of the things they were taught. They did the best they could, right?
They did the best they could.
And this is what they've done. You know, even with the railroad, they say they invented the railroad. Yeah, we now know that the Asians invented the railroad. They just took the railroad to another level. That's all they do. They take some things that they get, and they do. And you know, we got to give them credit for that because, you know.
They do what they do.
They do what they do. But, you know, just don't take credit for it. Just tell the truth where you got the initial information from, dude.
Exactly. Because it just brings such a false sense of who they are and a false sense of who we are because we're, you know, a lot of people, a lot of our people, we don't even think that we're smart enough to do anything, you know. But when in actuality, we invented mostly everything. If you took away all of our inventions, it wouldn't be anything here. I mean, so many different things that we brought into creation here that we use every single day. And a lot of people don't get credit. Like I heard, like, the Coca-Cola recipe got swapped for $500 from a
a man living in an old shack. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's a billion
dollars.
Yeah,
and they use cocaine in that shit, too.
Right.
They was using cocaine for everything. A toothache? Come on, give me some of that coke. Let me put it in my mouth. So, you know, they, oh, man, we, you know, it really is. You know, one thing that I've that's really, you know, shocked me is the level of ignorance people have, you know. There's just so much ignorance, you know. People just, you know, you hear something on TV, you know, a preacher told you or your professor at school told you something, and you take it and you hold it as truth, but without taking the time to research it yourself, you know.
Yeah.
Double check. Mm-hmm. What is this dude saying to me, man? Is this really true? Let me go look this up, you know. Mm-hmm. People always quoting Bible verses. You know, the Bible says you got to be a prudent man, which
you're
is, you know, double check.
But that's what we were talking about earlier. It's like these people say all of these things. They don't believe. They don't want to research. But yet, you're not even following what you proclaiming and professing to believe in. You know, you know, it's just, to me, about, that's why I say I don't even want to talk to people who don't do the research. I mean, as far as, you know, we get on the religious level. I mean, don't come to me unless you research and study. And then come to me so we can reason and talk about it and we can agree to disagree and it's all love, you know.
And have some humbleness and respect to you when we're discussing it. Don't just put me aside and just say, well, that nigga don't know nothing, you know.
Right.
He ain't got no PhD next to his name. He don't know nothing.
Right. So. Labels. And that's what we get tied up into, a lot of labeling. You know, what's your job? What do you do? How long have you been in school? Well, how many degrees you have? And we think that that makes that person more valuable than ourselves. And it's such a lie, because you can have somebody, that a woman in the country that's 80 years old, and she's nothing but a library book full of wisdom and knowledge.
Exactly.
And you have somebody graduating from Yale, and he don't know shit. You know, so it's just like,
no,
you know,
common sense or nothing.
Nothing. Mm. You know, so that's
why shows, again, I keep coming back to this. This is what I really mean. That's why shows like yours and others across the country are so important, because we need to get this information out, you know, whether it's through rebroadcasting the show, you know, when you get more memberships or whatever. We need to pass this information along. You know, it's not enough for me to just sit on my couch and know all this stuff about melanin.
Right.
You got to share it with somebody, man. We got too many people that understand this stuff that is afraid to get off that couch and get out here and teach the people, you know?
Yeah, that's true. And so many people could benefit because, you know, the ones that are meant to hear it, they will hear it and they will listen, you know. And the ones that don't, you know, you just keep it moving. It's not a big deal.
Right. And we ain't gonna save everybody. Some people ready to die. Some people ready to die. There's some people suicidal with their actions and their behaviors.
Right.
They don't wanna live. Look at how they're living. They ready, you know what I mean?
Exactly. Renegade. So
yes, ma'am. Hello, Mr. Feather.
Yeah.
I couldn't hear
your
phone. Kind of. Okay. Yes.
Oh. Okay. Yeah, Brother Steve, you want to take some calls?
Sure.
Okay.
All right. Let's try area code 760. Hello. Question or comment, or just sipping tea?
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Good evening to you all. I remember I got this link for the show from a friend of mine. There was a particular topic that said the sisterhood panel will be discussing, and I quote, brains, booty, and beauty, how do black women see each other and how it affects relationships with each other and men. Are you guys going to get on that topic?
You say, where is it at, sister?
It's the link my friend sent me about this show tonight. What are you guys ever going to get on that topic?
Oh, and they said the topic was going to be on what? I'm sorry.
It said tonight's show's Blog Talk Radio, the Sisterhood panel will be discussing brains, booty, and beauty. How do black women see each other and how it affects relationships with each other and men?
Oh, I
think
that's not a part of your topic.
Yeah, he sent me the whole link together. He sent me the whole link together. I was like, okay.
Oh, yeah, cause, and you said it said the sisterhood something.
Mm-hmm. No booty and beauty tonight, sweetie. We're talking about
that's what I was doing. I'm reading on the link right now. I'm reading it word for word off the link, and I'm like, okay, where is that topic coming? I just wanted to hear about, you know, the black women and the, you know, relationships and all that good stuff. That's what I was waiting to hear. So,
I didn't know about that.
Yeah, oh, okay. All right. Well, I guess he sent me the wrong link then. Okay.
Yeah, we apologize.
Okay, no problem.
Okay. All right. Okay, let's try area code 562. Question or comment, you're on the line.
Yes, hi. I was just wondering, for the young lady that just called, I was letting her know that that show aired earlier today, so she missed that one.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, that was on earlier today, and then this one here is about Melon, so... She just got crossed up because I was sent the link too. So I listened to that show earlier today, and then now I'm listening to you guys. And I am a newborn mm-hmm. African American because I mm-hmm. just started studying and trying to get in touch with my culture. And I've been, you know, researching. I've been looking around, and I just have. And I know you guys are talking about Melanin and you know, our color and this, you know. But mm-hmm. I don't really have a question. I just want to know to tell Brother Stevie, thank you very much because I've learned listening. I've learned a lot in just this little length of time. So I really appreciate you guys for taking my call. I just wanted to say that.
All right.
Thank
well, thanks, sister,
appreciate
for calling.
You, sister.
Okay,
you're welcome. Okay. Have a blessed one. Thank you. Awesome. All right, let me see. Next, we're going to try area code 412. Question or comment or sipping tea?
Oh, Jeff, sisters and gods, goddesses, how we doing today?
Oh, Jeff, brother.
Okay.
Brother Raj, how you doing?
I'm good. Thank y'all very much. You know, it's been a great show, very informative. Goddess, he always does a good job. And whoever, whatever you call him for, with this type of information, that's what you need to just go ahead and take that in the best that you can. Bring out your pencil and paper and take you some notes. You know, so you can maintain on the brains and the beauty and the booty as it is. But anyway, I just want to piggyback somehow for what Brother Steve was saying. You know, the melanin is a powerful thing for a lot of us. And, you know, a lot of times when I'm talking to the brothers and sisters and we're talking about music and we get to talking about how white people tend to dance to the music and other cultures, you know, and I have to kind of like explain to them, like, you know, that you have to study some of the melanin to understand that we have the highest melanin content, which is in your ears and in your eyes, as y'all talked about. But in your ears, it enables you to be able to hear the music. You know, white people can't necessarily hear the music like we can. So that beat and everything is totally different to them. They mm-hmm. cannot see the colors the way we can see the colors. Mm. You know,
is this why blacks have more? So I've read they had a higher content of earwax or something like. Is that related to the melanin?
Yeah, Brother Steve knows about that. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, Brother Steve, also do me a favor and touch on Brother Diop going in to check out the mummies and everything and how that went down.
Oh, that sounds exciting. Mm-hmm. Brother Steve?
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Okay, I didn't hear the question. What was the question again?
Brother Raj, can you touch on the mummies, was it, Brother Raj?
Yeah, the mummies that are referring to Dr. Diop.
Okay, as far as, yeah, I heard the part about the ear. That's a great point. When you look at, you know, our ability to see and hear, as I mentioned earlier, our senses, right?
Uh-huh.
We can look at a perfect example I like to use is Beethoven, right? When we look
right.
at Beethoven now, we clearly understand now through movies like Hidden Colors and great scholars like, you know, Phil Valentine, Dr. Kaba, we now know that Beethoven's real name was Thoven Day. He was an African.
Huh.
Mother was
really?
A black woman, okay?
Okay.
Oh, yeah,
mm-hmm.
without a doubt. And how is this brother able to make this music and be deaf?
Right.
You understand?
I didn't know he was half black.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Wow. How was wow. Stevie Wonder able to do the things he's able to do?
Right.
Melanin. Melanin is powerful,
yeah.
y'all. Melanin
yes.
is powerful.
Yeah, you know, you never see a white blind man playing instrument. I mean, I haven't seen a celebrity that's blind or deaf or something playing instrument. So yeah.
Yeah. And the part about the mummies, I didn't understand. My phone was breaking up a little bit. He was asking me about Brother Diop, you said, Brother Raj?
Yeah, Dr. Diop, his experiment with going into the
mummies.
Well,
what he did was he was able, in 1974, in a symposium in Cairo, him mm-hmm. along with Brother Theophile Obanga and a couple of other brothers, was able to show the European scholars. See, initially, we got to understand that we got into Egyptology. This is going to hurt some feelings. We got into mm-hmm. Egyptology because white people was in it. They were studying it. They were taking the artifacts. They was claiming it for themselves. So some of us had to be like, hold up, man. Slow down a minute, man. Let me study this and figure out what's really going on to be able to disprove, because we can't let y'all claim what's really ours. You know, for a while, they were saying Egypt wasn't even in Africa. Okay?
Wow.
That was separated. Mm-hmm. That was somewhere part of the Mediterranean. So we need to initially understand that. Now, Diop, the great man that he was, and I put him on the front of my book, How Did I Get Here from a Kushite to a Thug? He's right mm-hmm. in the top of the center of my, in the front cover of my book, because of the many things that he brought forth to our civilization. And one of the mm-hmm. things that he created was a melanin test. He created a test, and to simplify it, to be able to check and see how high the level of melanin was in the mummy skin. He would take a piece of the mummy skin, put it under a microscope, do his test, and prove to the Europeans that this mummy was black. Now, when he started to figure that out, they shut him down. They stopped giving him access to the mummies. But the mummies that he was able to test, he proved without a shadow of a doubt that these mummies were black. These pharaohs were black. Okay? That's why when you see some of the pharaohs, you know, the museums I've been to, I've been blessed to have elders that have traveled that have given me pictures of you know, the British Museum, the museum in Chicago, mm-hmm. the museum in Boston, of all these Egyptian, these Kemet artifacts, mummies, different things. And you look at some of them, like Hatshepsut or Queen T, you're like, man, look like she just died the other day. Here, look the same, everything. I'm like, whoa, hold up here.
Right?
So Diop, the brother who created the monogenetic theory, came along and said, yo, I'm going to create a test that'll prove that these mummies were black. And he was doing it, and they shut that brother down.
Wow.
He was a multi-genius. You know, our kids need to understand who Diop was. His real, you know, the real pronunciation of his name is Joke. She called it Joke. The D is sound like, you know, sound like a J. So, you know, he is one of, if not the greatest mind that we've ever produced. Brother knew 13 languages. 13 languages. I mean, a deep brother.
Brother Steve, spell his name out again.
Shake onto Diop. CHEIKHANTADIOP. Shake onto Diop.
Okay, because this is important. Because, you know, I heard, I don't know if you're familiar with Art Bell, but he does a, he's European, he does a lot of
paranormal
first
shows.
Yeah, and
him and another scholar were on there, and they were saying that the black people are delusional because we think that the Egyptians were African, were black Africans.
Right.
And they had a whole 2-hour show going in, and they said that the Egyptians originated from the Europeans, and we're delusional. I mean, they just went in on this show. And
yeah,
there's a lot of this going on out here to, you know, keep us in confusion. So it's really very important, you know, that you guys do your research and really read about this stuff.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. It's a great point.
Yes, agents or whatever you want to call them out here that are out here just to poison us, to have us think of something else.
That's so true. That's so true.
Mm-hmm.
They tried to claim things. What they tried to do, to simplify, is to make a place for themselves in world history. Because they can only go back so far. Because they weren't here until about 40,000 years ago. There was no white folk.
Right.
So they've had to find a way to make claim to history. To make their you know, that's why they rewrote history.
Mm-hmm.
That's why Alexander the Great did what he did. And that's why he put the Ptolemy in power. And that's why they burned so many of the libraries, right? So
mm-hmm.
if it wasn't for places like the House of Wisdom, which is in Baghdad, which the Islamic Brothers call Medina, right?
Uh-huh.
If it wasn't for places like that, you know, or, you know, we wouldn't have a lot of this history because they stopped them from burning certain things and preserved it.
Wow.
Which we were able to go back and dig and dig and find out the truth on certain subjects, right? Now,
mm-hmm.
the thing about the monogenetic theory, this is what blows the European philosophy theory out the water.
Mm-hmm.
There has never been anywhere in the world outside of Africa, Akhe-Buland, whatever you want to call it, where we find the first three species of man, the fossils of the first three species of man. And I challenge any listener anywhere in the world to disprove that. They have not found the fossils of the three first so-called three species of man anywhere
mm-hmm.
outside of Africa.
Wow.
Which is the Australopithecus line, the two Australopithecus, gracile and robust, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which was the most important, that was the initial, human-like, man-like being ever on this planet. And they've never found outside of Africa, anywhere, the fossils of an Australopithecus. Now they try to say we like monkeys, and that's a whole other subject, sisters. But you know, when we get into that, when we break that down, we can understand Sheikh Anta Diop's monogenetic theory. Now the Europeans created what's called the polygenetic theory, which they said that mankind was born all over the world, not just in Africa, because they didn't want to give us credit. You know, how do you give credit for someone that you've oppressed so much?
Exactly.
Understand?
They're like fools. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they couldn't do that, you know? And that's this is why, Pope Nicholas V said, you know, go ahead and put these people, he told Ferdinand, Isabella, and Don Juan, the kings and queens of Spain and Portugal, go ahead, y'all enslaved them infidels. They ain't even human anyway. How they get that philosophy? Where'd that come from?
Right.
They had to hide the fact that they, you know, come on, just think about that. You can't impress somebody that's your grandmama.
Right.
You know, you gotta sleep at night. So, you know, those shows like that, Bell, and he's, you know, Bell Curve is probably, I heard of his, the book, The Bell Curve, which is another racist book that was created by that brother you were talking about. And I read portions of the book, and it's out there. But, you know, they try to, again, discredit the fact that, you know, all humanity in one way or another started from our ancestors, y'all.
Right. And, I mean, all they have to do is, when you go to Africa, we have the mummies, we have the evidence that we existed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, can we find Paul or John, though? Can we find Luke?
Right.
Can we find any of those theologian figures anywhere?
Right.
But I could go find Ramses, Ursa Maat, Ross, and Tepin Ra. I can go find, Hatshepsut, Queen T. I know where they're at. I know where they're buried. Right now, Tony Browder's over in Egypt and Kemet right now. They just found a whole new area that they now call Naptopliya. sisters, which is 65 miles south of Egypt, where they found a whole new area of black people that they are now dating 8,000 to 10,000 years prior to even the first dynasty of Egypt.
Oh,
come on now. Stop playing around. He sent pictures back of, and I was fortunate to be able to sit at his feet and meet him through my elder Kaka. I was able to meet him and talk to Tony Browder, and he sends me information, different things like that. And he sent me a picture of a priest that they found and they dug up called Karakamun. And this brother looked like Brother Roger's twin. Looked just like him.
Wow.
There ain't no way in heck this brother ain't no African. So they need to stop playing. They need to stop playing
do.
And stop
really
lying to
them. They do. Enough is enough.
Enough is enough.
You're dying out anyway. So.
Right. And it's not right. Yeah, we ain't got to take credit for everything because we ain't do everything. But we ain't going to let you take credit for something that we did, you know, because other races have added to humanity, Asians. You know, we've all played our
part,
right?
It's just like we can never take credit for things they done. You know,
exactly.
They wouldn't let us take credit for what they did. They're going to stand up and fight to the death.
Right. Yes, they will.
You know, so,
yes, they
but the same respect isn't reciprocated, so it's just like, you know,
mm-hmm.
but long as, this is why we need these shows and people like, you know, to get this information out there because, I mean, this is the type of stuff that just blows your mind. If you, you know, instead of watching Love and Hip Hop, you know, you need to get with this.
Yes. And that's why Brother Raj and us have spent so much time working and writing these books because, you know, the one we're working on now, Conversations with My Elders, is we've been working on for almost 2.5 years consistently. And we want to make sure that we get it right because we now know that this book is not going to be just for our generation. This is 50 years from now. The stuff that I'm reading was written in the 60s and the 50s and all these different scholars that, you know, that were living that we never even heard of. You know, John G. Jackson, you know, all these different powerful brothers that, you know, put their, you know, Chancellor Williams, Amos Wilson, Bobby Wright, you know, all these dudes that you'd be like, who's that? Who's that? What's that? You know, dudes that was putting it down, researching that we've never heard of because they have now, they're burying these brothers. But the key with that is that brothers and sisters like ourselves are digging them back up. And we found in this information that they put down 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago. That's the same thing. And I realized, like, you know, with the work that I'm doing now, you know, most likely after I transition, this stuff, people say, man, that dude knew what the hell he was talking about, you know? You know, but they spit on you while you alive. So that's just
exactly.
Part.
This is definitely the least walk fast.
Yeah.
You know. Wow. Thank you, Brother Raj, for calling in.
Thank you. Let's try another thing. We have another caller with a question. Area code 310.
Hello.
Hello. Question or comment or just sipping tea?
My name is Sophita. I was calling in because, like, I hear you guys, your topic is melanin, correct?
Yes.
Yes.
I was wondering, like, what do you guys suggest a way that we can get it to our people that it's important, that it is strength, that it does represent more than what they teach us? Because, like, I have my nieces, three of them. They're 6, 4, and 2, and they're all girls. And the little one that's 4, she's kind of insecure about her hair already, you know, she's only 4.
Aww.
And it's because she goes to school with a majority Hispanic girl who has stringy hair and they're like lighter than her. So I think those two things go hand in hand, which is our hair and our melanin. So I'm like, I kind of need advice as to way, because, you know, they're kids. I don't want to be so aggressive with them, like, you know, because the way I was trying to express my feelings to my niece about her hair, I think she was getting kind of, like, sad, like maybe I was being too harsh. So, like, what do you guys suggest that we, because you got to start young. You can't wait till they get 16 and 17 and be like, okay, well, your skin's beautiful. The reason why I'm so confident is because I'm darker than most. And the reason why I'm so confident is because my grandfather, when I was a kid, he always told me, like, you're the cutest one. And it was because I had my cousin who was mixed. my grandfather, he didn't care that it hurt her feelings.
Right.
He made sure he let me know that because I was the darkest one, I was the prettiest one. So I automatically grew up with this confidence that it didn't matter what people said to me in school because I got teased for being dark and the dark date or the comments, but it didn't really affect me because at home, at a young age, my grandfather already started, "You're beautiful, your hair is beautiful." So when I went to the world, it really didn't matter because the person that I really looked up to was my grandfather, and he already had instilled that into me. So, I mean, I don't want to be so harsh to my nieces. So I'm really, I guess it's just advice that I'm asking you guys for.
Well, I feel like that your aunt, I feel like your grandfather, you know, your ancestor, he was preparing you for this. So that's why he instilled all of that in you, so you can instill all of that in them.
I agree.
And you have to follow that same path that he, you know, laid out for you. Look how you turned out, confident, beautiful. So you have to give them that same confidence. You have to build them up because nobody's out in the world is going to do it. You have to do it. And coming from somebody they love, they'll know that it's true, and they don't have to seek this. They won't have to seek gratification from other ones to feel validated of who they are, their hair, or their complexion. It won't matter because you told them they're beautiful. You told them what they possess, and so that's what you have to instill in them. What was instilled in you? That's why he prepared you for that.
I agree. I didn't really think of it that way, but now that you said it, it's kind of sticking for me. Maybe he did prepare me for this today, because like as I think about it, out of all the grandchildren, I'm the only one that is opening, becoming more conscious and aware of who I am as a black woman.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, I'm supposed to post those things and research about it, and my cousins be looking at me like, "You sound like granddad," and it's kind of crazy to me that I'm the only one that got it. So that's what I don't want to do to my niece, because one's, like, they got the same mother and father, but one's, like, a little lighter, one's dark, and then one's brown. So I don't want to do that same thing that my grandfather did, made me strong because I was the darker one, when he allowed my cousin, who was mixed, basically, with black and white, Janaea, my cousin, made her more, like, weak, you know, and we were both from the same grandfather, but she's more of a weaker woman than me. But because my grandfather instilled dark means strength. The darker you are, the stronger you are. That's what he always told me.
Uh-huh.
It's putting a smile on my face, even remembering it, that how he used to tell me, like, don't worry about it when they call you dark. That means you're stronger. And I always kept that in my head, that I was strong, and that's what I live by. So, I mean, it's kind of hard raising kids, and I don't even have any, but being that they're my nieces, I'm helping. So I just want to be sure, because the women, like, we're more important than men, because they're going to be mothers. You know, they're going to reproduce.
Uh-huh.
So they have to be strong to know who they are and what they possess. So I pretty basically
your grandfather, he's around you, and he's there, and he's going to help guide you with your nieces. So you don't have anything to worry about. You just keep doing what you're doing and keep speaking life and positivity, and they'll grow like beautiful flowers. That's all you have to do.
Yes, they will. Nothing ever dies. The ancestors intend to speak through us. They use us in ways that we don't clearly understand. And like the sister said, I couldn't have said it better, you know. Just keep doing what you're doing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Be humbled and grateful that you've been able to receive this information and understand it, you know.
Yes.
Because so many of us are in a state of mental retardation that we just can't, we're not going to get it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
We are the blessed ones, and it's on us to take it upon ourselves to help other people.
Yeah, most definitely.
Well, thanks a lot. I appreciate it, and I'll continue to listen to you guys. Thanks.
All right. Thanks, sister. Thanks for calling.
No problem.
That was beautiful. This just
it
just makes what we're doing, you know, just, you know, so much more. It just really means a lot, and we know that we have a mission here, and we have to instill this into the next generation. We have to build them up and make sure that they are confident and secure with who they are, and just teaching them self-love, and it doesn't matter what anyone says about you, that you are beautiful and you are loved.
Yes, yes. Black is beautiful.
Everything. Yes, it is very, very beautiful.
Yeah, this whole colorism thing is serious, you know.
It is, and it's getting worse.
Being a brown skin, it's getting worse. You know, being a brown skin brother, I was always, you know, I have a dark skin brother who's, you know, like dark like a Flavor Flav, you know. And we used to tease him all the time. You know, little blackie, you know. And it, you know, now looking back, I'm ashamed of that behavior, you know. Because he was more closer to the Creator than all of us was. You know what I mean?
So the joke was on
us. Right.
The joke was on us.
Yeah. You know. And see, that's what makes the journey so beautiful, because you just, you know, just when you think, you know, you might feel like, you know, ashamed of it, but actually you grew from that. You know, look at you now.
Yeah, true, true.
Look at you now. And it takes a big man to admit that he's ashamed of that behavior. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Colorism is real, you know. Look at a lot of our leaders. A lot of our leaders have been light skinned. You know, they you know, this ain't by accident, you know.
Oh no.
And that that's another story. Look,
you know.
With the presidents and how they're all related, and how, you know, we could get into politics and voting and all that, but that, like I said, that's another show, you know.
Yes.
Most definitely. Trust me, listeners, we have pages and pages of topics to talk about. So we feel like you guys will never be bored, because we just, so many things that need to be discussed.
Yeah, so true.
Yes. So do we got time for another call, I hope, or?
Let me see. Yes, I think we got about 10 more minutes. Let's see. I'm not sure if this was. No, I think that was. Well, let me check again, because I think this call dropped, but they came back on. Hold on. Area code 562. Did you have a question or comment? Hello? Okay, I think maybe the call dropped and it just came back in. But yeah, so we can just round
Brother
it up.
Yeah. Brother Steve, you have any last and final words you want to talk about to our listeners?
Oh, yeah. You know, I just want to, again, say it's just been a beautiful experience being with, you know, being here with sisters and talking and building. You know, a lot of people get down on our culture today and talk about how, you know, we're so messed up and how, you know, and I was one of them. When I first started coming into this knowledge, you know, I used to say, man, we messed up. Brother Raj used to say, no, we ain't, man. Because look at you, you know, look at the situation now. Look at the knowledge, you know. It's good for us to stay, you know, optimistic, positive about the situation. Think positive, and you know, and put, you know, positive vibes out to the universe, and that things will get better. You know, and like the sister said earlier, it ain't for everybody to make it. You know, but those of us that are, you know, capable of understanding this information has a duty. It's our responsibility. You know, when you look at the ancestors, the number one thing, and it stood out to me, the number one thing that they did in a lot of African cultures, because all Africa ain't the same, but a lot of African cultures, the Bamdiwa, you know, the brothers from Mali, different countries, different places, they understood the greatest thing that they could give was to sacrifice themselves for their community. Actually uplift their community, right? We're so selfish and egotistical and today that we don't even care. We ain't even looking at our neighbors. We don't want to know our neighbors. We don't want to talk. All we worried about is getting that money.
Yeah.
You know? So that's what I would like to leave. You know, just let's all play our small part in the, you know, because I'm not bigger than a brother who's coaching Little League, who's influencing the young brothers and helping them. We all play a role. You know? Let's just do what we need to do in whatever field you are. If you're a doctor, whatever you do, you're a teacher, lawyer, whatever, find a way to give back this knowledge. Just recently, I took my nephew, who is 6'3", 280 pounds, 15 years old, okay?
Ooh.
And we took him to the doctor, big brother.
Ooh.
And it so happened to be a black male doctor, right? And the doctor, when I was telling him, you know, a little bit about, you know, my nephew and how he's been getting in trouble, he stopped and sat there with us in the room for about 40 minutes talking to him about his story and how he should get himself together. That's a perfect example. And whatever we do, we have to help. You have to figure out how you can give back to the community.
Whatever you do.
You know, if you coach in Little League, add a study group to the practice, man. It ain't just about football banging your head up against somebody and busting your knees up.
Teach these dudes
about their history. Add a study. Make them come to study group. If you want to be on my team, you got to come to the study group. Simple as that.
Right.
And whatever you do, and that's what I like to leave with the people. We all have to play a part in this, revolution, whatever you want to call it, upliftment of the people, whatever term you want to use, we all play a role. This show is a part of it, you know?
Yes, it is.
Everything.
And when you said something that I wanted to touch on, when you said sacrifice, you can go back to the Bible with this one, to love this life is to lose it. So you have to be willing to sacrifice something down here. You know, you didn't come down here just to drive fancy cars and wear nice clothes and take trips around the world. That's not why you are here. You have something to do. Even rich people commit suicide. So if money was the answer, then why are they killing themselves?
Exactly. Right. Exactly. And all that is a damn piece of paper. That's all that is. That's not who you are.
Exactly. Paper that we give energy to. The paper has no value until we give it energy. We fighting, killing, having sex with this money.
It ain't giving it no monetary value anyway.
It's not that monetary value.
If you paying attention, so you know, the dollar value going down every day.
Exactly.
Yeah, you can't buy nothing with a dollar right now.
Right. I think Russia's dollar, they said it tanked, you know. I mean, people, we can't be worrying about material things. Yeah, we want to be, you know, we want to look nice, all of those things, but don't make that your priority.
Yes.
You know, that's not your priority. Your priority is for you to go inside and remember who the hell you are. That's your priority.
Right.
And if you don't know who you are and you're confused about it, there are so many holistic practitioners out there that can help you with it. They do Reiki, that do past life regression, energy work. I mean, there are people out there that can help you get to that next level. So don't be afraid to ask for help. We're here. We're online. Yeah. God's sweet. We have a Facebook page. Mr. Brother Steve, he has a Facebook page also, Steve Johnson. And you can find us, and we're here. You can contact us at godissweet@gmail.com if you have any questions or you just need some, you know, you need some assistance. And that's what we're here for. We're here to serve and, you know, help each other. You take one step forward, and you should be able to reach your hand back and pull up the next person. And I think if everybody kind of did that, then we could continue to evolve as a people.
Yeah, indeed. Mm-hmm. Most definitely. Well, we want to give honor and thanks and blessings and praises to you, Brother Steve, for coming on our show again and dropping that science, dropping those jewels for the people. We appreciate it. We want you back on as usual.
Anytime, sister. Just let me know. And I'm here for you. I know last week I was supposed to come on, it was a mishap with the timing, but I tell you what, anytime you sisters need me, please reach out to me, and I'm here for you, because that's what we got to do, you know. Like I said, it's not enough for me to just have this information. We got to get it out to the people. We have to. It's a duty.
Exactly. It's part of our work, and we have to start doing our work, and that's part of it, you know, getting the information out. And it's just a blessing to meet people that are like-minded, that we can build with and keep adding to this soul group that we have down here. And I'm just, you know, honored.
Peace and blessings to you, sisters. Peace and blessings to you, sisters. Stay strong and keep doing what you're doing. You know, there's going to be some people, some adversity coming. Y'all know that.
But that cannot stop us. You know, we had adversity and we were doing other things. So, you know.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, it's just part of it. And they told me, ain't nobody going to read that damn book, man. What you doing wasting your time, you know?
Yeah. I'm like, I'm the little engine that feed.
That's right.
Keep it moving. Keep it moving. Well, Brother Steve, thank you so much. Thank you to our listeners.
Thank you.
We can be reached at goddesssweet@gmail.com. Brother Steve, you want to tell them about your book and where you can be reached?
Yeah, you can reach me on I have a website, swjbooks.com. swjbooks.com. You can order my stuff off of there. My stuff is available through the European outlets, you know, Kindle, Nook, Barnes & Nobles, all those different places. But, you know, if you want to support a brother, please go to the website and download it from there or purchase it from there. And, again, we're working on a new book we hope to have out here pretty soon called Conversations with My Elders, which is you're basically a resource guide. It's not just a book about, you know, stories or conversations. It's actually a resource guide. It's going to have chapters on health, rites of passage, the art of war, all different types, you know, racism, poverty. So, you know, and at the end of each chapter, we're going to have a resource where, for instance, in health, we're going to have a breakdown of melanin, what foods to eat, what you know, the difference between acid and alkaline. So, you know, it's going to, we're going to put a lot of work into this book that we hope that will help some folks.
Wow, that sounds beautiful. I can't wait for that to come out. Please keep it.
I can't either. I'm already putting it out there in the universe that it's going to be a bestseller because there's no book out there right now that has the whole spectrum, spirituality and health, it just everything. Just it's going to be, I'm putting it out there and I already see it. So that is going to be a blessing to a lot of people.
Yes. All right, then. Well, we thank you all for listening and tuning in. And tune in next Tuesday, and we'll be posting who our guests will be. But until then, love, peace, and light, and soul.
Hotep, sister.
Hotep.
Hotep. Good night, everyone.